Welcome everybody to another Off-Tech webinar. My name is Thiago and I'm the Global Marketing Director at Off-Tech. So today we'll be addressing complicated cataract cases and we're gonna look at tricks and tips. And for that we have invited two experts. So here in the studio in Amsterdam, I have Dr. Apostolov with me from the OLVG Hospital in Amsterdam, the Netherlands, who's going to talk about mainly subluxated IOLs. He's going to give his experience, show us lots of videos, and I hope that you can have a lot of questions so that he can answer and help all of us. So he will talk also about how he uses the Artisan lenses in a pre-propular way. Next to that, we have the pleasure to have Matteo Forlini from Italy, who will be addressing also very complicated aphakia cases. Mm-hmm. But interesting, he likes to use the Artisan retropupillary. So maybe we can have a discussion at the end of the seminar about pros and cons of both techniques. Furthermore, Matteo will tell us about the new iris prosthesis from Off-Tech Reper, a prosthesis that is used for aniridia patients. Interesting because it's a foldable prosthesis with hundreds of different colors that you can choose from. And also very interesting, it has an optic, so you can add optical power. So lots of videos today, and I hope to get a lot of questions from the audience. I think it's going to be very educational. You can place your questions down to the chat, and we'll have the time to, after each presentation, to answer to all of them. May we not be able to answer for some reason, maybe there's not enough time, we will make sure to send you an email afterwards with the answers to your questions. I wanted to tell you as well that this webinar is being recorded. So if you had some peers that could not be here today, they'll have the opportunity to see it on demand. You can use the same link you have used to log in. During the webinar, there's going to be not many, but a few poll questions, like the one that you are seeing on your screen now, just to have some interaction between the audience and us. So I hope you enjoyed today. And again, I hope you have enough questions so that we can answer all of them. And I will give the room now to Dr. Apostolov. Thank you very much for being here. And please, feel free.
Hello, my name is Valentin Apostolov. I'm working in the OLVG hospital, the city hospital of Amsterdam, together with 13 other eye doctors and some 4 to 5 residents. I'm doing cataract surgery, glaucoma surgery, as well as difficult cataract eyes and manage some complicated cases. I'll talk today about the use of the Artisan iris fixated lens. Historically, that's one of the options for managing aphakia. Historically, the oldest probably is the anterior chamber angle supported IOLs. Another option is, of course, the Artisan, and there are a number of different techniques for scleral fixation of intraocular posterior chamber intraocular lenses by means of transscleral suturing, the Chariot technique, the Yamane technique recently, and others. So let's start with giving some, well, all of those techniques have, of course, none is perfect. They have their upsides and downsides. Well, as a rule of the thumb, do whichever technique you are familiar with and comfortable with. That's the best technique for every surgeon. The Artisan lens, it's a PMMA lens, and it has an optic diameter of 5.4 millimeters. Remember that when implanting this lens. It uses the principle of fixation to the iris, and the point chosen to fixate the lens to, it's the periphery of the iris, not the furthest periphery, but the part which moves at least when the pupil moves from constricted to dilated and back. so that it causes as little trauma to the iris as possible. When implanting an artisan lens, the location and the construction of the incisions is different than when doing phaco. When doing phaco, one makes a 2.2 whatever incision at the location he prefers, and one or two paracenteses, and all of them are pointed to the middle of the pupil. When implanting an artisan lens, one needs to make the main incision 5.5 millimeters and make the side ports wide enough to accommodate the vacuum fix or the instrument of your choice, and point those side ports not at the pupil, point them at the periphery of the iris at the points where the lens will be fixated. Okay, well, a couple of maybe basic pearls at the beginning of this surgery. First, the anesthesia. Artisan can be done with intracameral anesthesia, but I strongly prefer using subtenons because it immobilizes the eyes, and I do that, maybe you can see that, not with the subtenon needle, but with a Simcoe needle, much easier. And one more. It's illustrating making the incisions. So in this case, I make the side ports with the phaco knife, but look, I take care to make them wide enough and in the proper direction, which is the periphery of the iris at 3 and 6 o'clock, 3 and 9 o'clock mostly. Okay, so that's the first case, I believe.
So you're performing here the main incision?
Yes, I start here with the main incision. Sometimes I start with the main incision, sometimes I start with the side ports. And the video is gone.
Okay.
The video, is it running?
Yes.
I don't see it. Okay. No, that's the second one. Third one.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Back to the incisions. Generally, I prefer to make the two side ports first and then use two instruments to move the lens to the anterior chamber. So I know for sure it will not fall into the vitreous when I make the main incision. When using two instruments, I like also to remove the rest of the zonuli in a zipper-like fashion, not all them at once, but part by part. And then the lens, if it's a foldable lens, it's quite easy to get out through a 5.5 millimeter incision. Inject myocol to constrict the pupil, wash away some cortical material if present. Don't disturb the vitreous if possible. When the pupil is smaller, then it's time to implant the lens. There are different instruments for the artisan forceps. You will probably see all three of them on one video or another. I like to use it a bit differently than advised by Oftec. Normally, one grasps the lens in the middle, and I prefer to grasp it closer to the close because I have a bit more control. Okay, then one can say I'm more than a bit obsessive about the iris bridges and the centration of the lens. Here I was, in this case, I was quite pleased with the position of the lens, but I thought the iris bridges are on the thin side, so it's not that easy to pull more iris tissue through the close. You grasp the iris with a fine forceps, like for example the capsular axis forceps. Don't use the lens holding forceps for that because it will crush the iris. The capsular axis forceps, it's a thin instrument. It can only exert so much force. I guess the next video is coming.
Video number four is on.
No, it's not four. Okay, it's four. Yes, it is. Right, you are. Okay, that was a lens which was very, very mobile. So here I started with the main port because I was afraid that the lens may fall into the vitreous depths. And well, took care to bring at least a part of the lens out of the eye. Well, when evaluating a patient with subluxated IOL, don't forget to try to look where the lens stays when the patient is in supine position. You will not operate the patient sitting. When sitting, then the lens hangs behind the iris, and when the patient lays down on the operating table, well, sometimes the lens disappears behind the iris. That may be a nasty surprise. Okay, here, that's a case of three-piece IOL. Don't push too much on the haptic of a three-piece IOL. It will tear loose and the lens may recoil and fall down into the vitreous. When the lens is in the anterior chamber, grasp the optic and pull the lens firmly but slowly outside of the eye. Don't pull too far. When the lens is out of the eye, stop and take a good look if there is some vitreous. Don't pull the vitreous. One of the steps which I do pretty much every time is making an iridectomy. Well, it's officially may not be necessary, but I feel safer when I have it. It does not need to be big. Actually, if I could make a surgical iridectomy as small as a laser iridectomy, I would do so. If there's any vitreous in the anterior chamber or in the pupillary zone, remove it. Of course, vitrector is the preferable option. If you don't have, you can do that with a scissor the old-fashioned way. But don't leave any vitreous in the anterior chamber. Okay, here I'm using in this video the VacuFix. That's an instrument which aspirates the iris into a tiny hole and pulls it through the close and into the close. It's a very useful instrument and a very nice instrument, and it's very gentle to the iris. Well, after the iris is into the close, then I take a good look every time about the centration of the lens. When implanting an artisan lens, don't forget the cornea is not symmetrical. There is always, if you try to enclavate the lens both close at the same distance from the limbus, then the lens will not be centered to the pupil. If you centrate the lens at the pupil, then you may end up having much more iris, much closer to the limbus, respectively to the endothelium, and you don't want that. Next video, please.
Yes.
Okay, that's a rather old one. Here, a lens has to be removed, and there is also a capsular tension ring into this eye, into the capsular bag, which postponed the lens subluxation but did not prevent it. So here we see the haptic outside of the eye and also the end of the tension ring. Don't pull them. Put some visco into the anterior chamber, not too much, just to make some space to protect the endothelium. Take the lens out, take a good look, the vitreous is there. Don't pull it. Vitrectomy. Okay, here. I only use the aspiration and I don't irrigate any BSS into the eye. In this way, I don't pull the vitreous and I don't allow it to get out through the wound, which I don't want. It's a kind of like the open sky vitrectomy here during a penetrating keratoplasty. In this particular eye, there were a lot of goniosynechia, which I took the chance to pull open when busy into the eye. Well, you can constrict the pupil with myostat. You can also, well, tickle the iris a bit with an instrument to help it, the pupil get small. But in this case, the purpose was to make those synechia loose, to open the anterior chamber. So now the pupil is nice and round. There is an iridectomy which has been made earlier, so I did not have to make one. And next, the enclavation of the lens. Okay, here the side ports are good enough. And that's yet another forceps to grasp the lens. When filling the anterior chamber, don't use too much viscoelastic, because the iris will fall deeper and it's more difficult to grasp it. Put only enough OVD into the anterior chamber to make some space. Behind, if the eye is very soft, you can always use a thin cannula and go through the pupil behind the lens and inject BSS in the back part of the eye, not in the anterior chamber. Then the eye gets a bit more pressure and it's easier to grasp the iris. Sometimes there can be an air bubble in the eye. Well, don't forget, the vacuum fix is an aspirating instrument. It uses a high vacuum. I put it at the highest possible setting, I believe 600 millimeters, so you can remove some air bubbles if necessary with it. And, well, take a good look again. Is there enough iris in the close? Are the close positioned so that the optic centers in respect to the pupil, and if necessary, pull a little bit more iris tissue in front of the close, make a thick iris bridge. Maybe we can go to the next video. Well, it's finished.
Yeah, just a second, we'll go on to the next one. There you go.
Well, here we have another. In this case, I chose also to bring the lens first to the anterior chamber and used two instruments to achieve that. And most of those eyes are pseudo exfoliation eyes. You can see on a big screen, you can see also the pseudo exfoliations. Well, this lens was not difficult to grasp and pull out of the eye. There was no vitreous coming out. I omitted here the vitrectomy for the sake of time. Here, it's the vacuum fix again, and the classic forceps. Well, so you have to bring the vacuum fix in contact with the iris and then to press the aspiration and to hold it pressed long enough in order to aspirate enough iris into the opening. It does not happen within a second. There is some OVD in the anterior chamber, so it gets aspirated first. Wait a couple of seconds and then bring the vacuum fix up towards one of the clothes, and then through the middle. You actually elevate one of the clothes and you pull the iris between the elevated cloth and the other one. Okay, ensure that the eye is, looking straight forward. Sometimes they tend to stay in a position a bit more to the side, and then you don't see very well what you are doing with the iris periphery. So sometimes you need to center the eye one way or the other. And well, once again, when you pull the iris, you can grasp it on the anterior side of the lens, and when you pull upwards and you push back with this with the second instrument, then you get more iris into. And also when you pull the iris towards the pupil and you hold it on in front of the lens, then you get more iris tissue into the close. Well, the iridectomy as close, as small as possible and as peripheral as possible. Well, there is one more video, I think.
No, I think you had your videos, your six videos, Dr. Apostolov.
Oh, okay.
You had some take-home messages for us?
Yes. what's important? Well, I already told that I prefer a subtendon incision. Well, it's not that much because the procedure is painful. You can anesthetize the iris good enough with some lidocaine in the anterior chamber, but you don't want the eye to be moving when you are busy with the iris and with two instruments at the same time. Also, when you implant an artisan lens, when during the phaco emulsification, two instruments pegged into those small wounds, you can, well, move the eye the way you want. And with the artisan, if the incision is bigger, then you don't have much control of the eye. So akinesia is very important. Next, when starting the surgery, think twice. It's an artisan surgery. I need to make the side ports in the proper direction, and I need to make them wide enough. The anterior chamber, don't overfill. It makes your work more difficult. And also, on some of the videos, probably you could see there were some sutures placed on the cornea before starting the enclavation of the lens. If that's a very soft eye, if it's not moving, if there's no vitreous, well, okay. You can also do the whole procedure through the incision, but it's better if you put a couple of sutures, then you have a more stable anterior chamber, you don't get those folds on the cornea, you have better visibility. Okay, well, consider also the fact that the pupil is not in the middle, it's a bit displaced towards the nasal side and a bit upwards. You have to center the IOL. In some eyes, it's much more so. So you have to center the lens to the pupil, but also keep in mind that you don't want to put the close too close to the endothelium. It's a bit of a compromise. Okay, enough iris tissue in the close, that's essential. A lens may get also, one of the close may get loose or can tear through the iris after some trauma, and that's a dangerous situation. Okay, the iridectomy, well, you can also not do it. Personally, I prefer to do that. Does no harm. And don't forget to remove as much OVD as possible from the posterior chamber at the end of the surgery. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Apostolov. I think there was there were very nice tips and tricks that back home folks can use. I have a couple of questions. I've noticed that you had three-piece lenses in one of the videos, actually in two of them. And I saw that you had a CTR, or
yes.
Not you, but maybe with the surgery before that there was a CTR. How do you manage that? Does actually the CTR makes it easier for you to take off the lens, or does it make it more complicated? How does it work in your experience?
Well, it's no more difficult to remove a capsular bag with a capsular tension ring in it than without. It goes through the incision without any difficulty. One thing that is a bit more difficult is it's a bit more difficult to get behind the equator of the capsular bag. So you may need to go further with your instruments, further to the periphery, in order to get behind, to lift the equator. Once you have it in the anterior chamber, then, well, it does not make much difference. But never pull the capsular tension ring. Grasp always the optic of the lens.
Right. There's a lot of manipulation, and obviously there's a big incision on for this type of lenses for the artisan. What is your experience in terms of astigmatism? Do you try to account for it or not? Or how does it work with other techniques? Is that something you have in consideration?
Sure. I always take that into consideration. Well, eyes that don't have any astigmatism or not a substantial astigmatism, I place the incision superiorly, as I have some preference to orienting the lens in the horizontal direction. And when suturing the incision, I aim at, with the rule, astigmatism of some 3 to 4 diopters. Then it regresses by itself and comes out at about low value. If necessary, one can always remove the sutures later.
How long do you wait to remove the sutures?
It all depends on the amount of astigmatism I manage to create. If it's some high 6 diopters, then I may remove 1 or 2 of the sutures 1 month or a couple of months after the surgery. If I'm content with the astigmatism, I let them stay there for about a year, and ultimately I remove them, because if I don't do that, they get loose at certain point and start irritating the patient, and of course that will happen in the most inconvenient moment, like a vacation in some exotic country. When there is against the rule of astigmatism, it gets trickier, because making a bigger incision, it's also a chance to correct the pre-existing astigmatism. But when I place the incision temporarily, then it's more difficult to enclavate the temporal claw. Because of the incision, you don't see very well. Of course, you can orient the lens vertically, or otherwise you can enclavate the iris by grasping it with some thin forceps and pulling it through the claws.
Right. I saw that you are very versatile in the way that you implant the lens. So we saw you implanting the lens with the VacuFix, which is a suction system. We saw you implanting the lens, let's say the traditional way with the creating a wave of iris. But we also saw you using other forceps, other instruments, and coming, let's say, backwards onto the lens. Do you feel that there's a big difference between the techniques? Or is there maybe the danger of iris piercing that, or iris perforation when you do these different techniques? What's your experience?
Iris perforation, that's not impossible, but that's mostly in a very atrophic thin iris. Fortunately, I don't see that very often. As to the second instrument, the VacuFix is more gentle to the iris. I feel it's a bit less gentle to the claws, because it's wider. So I try to bring the iris into the claws using the thinnest instrument I have, which is also not sharp. And that's mostly the chopper, which I have on the OR table every time I do surgery. As to the direction of pulling or pushing the iris, actually you create a wave of iris. It does not matter if you create it from 12 o'clock towards 3 or 6 o'clock, or from 6 o'clock towards you. It's basically the same maneuver.
As long as there is a thick iris bridge.
Yes, a thick iris bridge.
Thank you very much, Dr. Apostolov, for your presentation. I think this was very interesting to find out about your experience. So now we're going to invite Dr. Forlini. Matteo, are you there?
Yeah.
Okay,
hello,
so welcome, Matteo. Matteo is connecting from Italy. Welcome to our studio here in Amsterdam. I will give you the floor. Please present yourself if you don't mind, and go ahead.
Sure. So thank you for kind invitation. I'm Matteo Forlini from Italy. I'm vitreo retinal surgeon, and I'm based in Ravenna, Italy, and I'm also a consultant on vitreo retinal surgery in San Marino Hospital. So I deal many times with ocular traumatology, both anterior and segment, anterior segment and posterior segment. So now we are talking about managing aphakia after ocular trauma, and you can show the slide. We have a lot of cases, a lot of scenarios in this kind of surgery. And during these years, we collected many cases about how to manage aphakia using iris claw in a retropupillary enclavation. So I'm talking about retropupillary implantation, and we divided a lot of cases in three main groups, so three main scenarios. So you, next slide, please. You can see scenario number one, group number one, is post-traumatic subluxation or total dislocation of crystalline lens and ruptured cataract lens without adequate capsular support. You can see the video. So this video that I'm showing is one of these cases of group one. You can see the subluxated cataract, very, very, with big zonal dialysis. And you can see that we try to do phaco. But during the phaco, we noticed that the zonal dialysis was very, very big, too much. So we stopped and we converted the surgery in ICCE, intracapsular cataract extraction. So we opened the cornea a lot at 5.5 millimeters. And now we are trying to remove the lens without intracapsular cataract extraction. And you can see that slowly, little by little, we are removing this big, big crystalline lens. And this was a big traumatic cataract. So we wanted to convert it in intracapsular cataract extraction because we wanted to avoid the risk of complete luxation of the crystalline lens in the vitreo chamber. You see, because the zonule and the bag was very, very weak. So we managed that. We saved the lens from falling down in the vitreo chamber. So just anteriorly, we removed all the lens. We are doing now the anterior vitrectomy using triamcinolone just to stay in the vitreous. And now, when the anterior chamber is clean, we are doing the enclavation of iris claw in the posterior surface of the iris. We are using anterior chamber maintainer to have a good chamber. And you can see now I'm holding the lens with the dominant hand, and with the other hand, I'm using a spatula to perform the enclavation. You just have to press very gently. You just have to press the iris in the haptics. And in this way, that's it. It's fast and easy. So next slide with the second video. I show you another case, this one, yes. This was severe ocular trauma after bottle cork trauma. So the bottle cork pushed the eye. So we have vitreous hemorrhage and we have complete dislocation of crystalline lens into the vitreo chamber. You can see the crystalline lens completely dropped on the posterior pole. So first I'm performing here complete parasplanar vitrectomy, because this is here is very important to create a complete vitrectomy with peripheral shaving. And now I'm injecting triamcinolone to complete the very, very peripheral vitrectomy up to the vitreous base. And now I found a large retinal tear. So this very large retinal tear, almost, it was almost 180 degrees, all the inferior peripheral retina. So anyway, the patient was lucky because this large retinal tear didn't provoke a retinal detachment. So the retina was still attached, and this was good, of course. So I'm just completing the endo laser along the big retinal tear. And now I'm completing the peripheral vitrectomy, because in these cases of ocular trauma, is very, very important to perform a complete vitrectomy. Now, after complete vitrectomy, I'm dealing with the lens. I'm just injecting a small bubble of PFCL on the posterior pole. And now I'm just removing the crystalline lens with the vitreous cutter and with the other hand. So bimanual maneuvers. And I am using the chandelier. So thanks to the chandelier, I can use both my hands. And I'm using a 23 gauge instrumentation. So with 23 gauge, you can easily eat all the crystalline lens, because the crystalline lens was soft. You can see the patient was young, so it was not cataract. It was just crystalline lens dropped in the vitreous chamber. And now I am in the anterior segment again. I'm removing some blood clots. You can see I'm removing the blood clots from the angle. And now again, I'm performing the iris claw implantation on the posterior surface of the iris. So this is the retropupillary enclavation. Of course, the iris was damaged, as you can see. There was a iridodialysis on the superior sector. So I just pushed the iris back in the anterior chamber, and I'm closing the corneal wound. I just put 4 stitches. And now I am trying to get a better pupil with Sipser sliding knot technique. This is my favorite choice of iridoplastic technique. It's a Sipser sliding knot technique, because it's very, very nice technique, very gentle. So the sliding knot is passed through the iris with the proline 10-0. And now I am completing the sliding knot. You can see this, the maneuver is to use the suture from one side to the iris, the other side to the iris. And then when I pull, the suture, the sliding knot goes into the anterior chamber, and the two sides of the iris go together. In this way, I create a better pupil, a smaller pupil. At the end, I just perform the final BSS fluid air exchange, because I prefer to finish the case with gas, and then final air gas SF6 exchange. And this is the final result. So you can see the pupil is well centered, the iris claw is stable and well enclavated in the posterior surface of the iris. So next slide, please. We go on. This is the group number two. Group number two is when you have a post-cataract surgery aphakia that resulted from intra or post-operative complications, and cases with subluxation or total dislocation of the IOL. In this video, you can see a dislocation of the IOL. So we are removing the IOL, because IOL was dislocated. This was a 3-piece IOL. So removal of subluxated IOL and enclavation of the iris claw. So this is sort of IOL exchange. So I removed the subluxated IOL and I implanted the new IOL, the iris claw, on the posterior surface of the iris. Also, in this case, I need to do the pars plana vitrectomy, because this patient developed a sort of vitreo iris. So I'm doing pars plana vitrectomy also. I'm staying with triamcinolone, the vitreous, and I'm creating a posterior vitreous detachment. You can see this is very, very nice image to see the posterior vitreous detachment. You see, I'm inducing the PVD, and when PVD is completed, I do the peripheral vitrectomy, so peripheral shaving. I'm using the light to indent the sclera. So this is a scleral indentation with the light. And then this is the final result. With the forceps, I just complete the good shape of the pupil. I just pull a little bit the iris to get a better pupil. And this is another good final result. So next slide, please, again. And finally, group number three. The group number three is patients in which keratoplasty was performed in association with vitrectomy and retropupillary iris claw implantation. So you can show the video. Video number 4, if you have it, we can try.
Yep.
Okay, yeah, video number 4. So this is a very severe ocular trauma with large iridodialysis. You can see huge iridodialysis and corneal wound. So first thing, we suture the corneal wound and we prepare the 3 trocars for the pars plana vitrectomy. In this case, the cornea was damaged, so we have to do keratoplasty. So we remove the cornea. This is open sky approach. We are performing the anterior vitrectomy in open sky. So this is open sky anterior vitrectomy, removing some capsular bag remnants, removing anterior vitreous. And also in open sky, we are performing the iridoplasty. So we are correcting the iridodialysis using Prolin 10-0 double arm. So we are still in open sky with this iridoplasty technique. And then we have to position the temporary keratoprosthesis by Eckert. And finally, we perform the pars plana vitrectomy. So we stain with triamcinolone. We are performing a complete vitrectomy. We are staining for the macula surgery. So we are performing ILM peeling under staining. And after ILM peeling, we are completing with the 360 endolaser. So we often do 360 degrees endolaser. And then finally, this is open sky because we remove temporary keratoprosthesis and we are doing the iris claw implantation in open sky in the posterior surface of the iris. So this is a retropupillary enclavation of the iris claw in open sky. After the retropupillary enclavation, we put the final corneal graft and we are performing PK, and this is it. So this was a very complex case. And next slide, please. So, as I said, surgical technique, it's similar to anterior enclavation, of course, but you have to remember some little bit of tips and tricks. So, first, tips and tricks. You have to remember that the constant of the iris claw, when you decide to do the enclavation of the on the posterior surface of the iris, the constant is 116.5, better 116.8, the A constant, okay? We remember that if you implant the iris claw on the anterior surface of the iris is 115.0, okay? So constant changes. Second rule, when you decide to do enclavation on the posterior surface of the iris, you have to change the natural, the vaulting. So you have to rotate the lens upside down. So conclusion, if you do the implantation on the anterior surface of the iris in the anterior chamber, you will put the lens like this, okay? But if you want to do on the posterior surface of the iris, you have to rotate upside down before entering in the eye, of course. So you prepare the lens before. Okay, this is very important to remember. Otherwise, you could create a block of the pupil. Usually, in our experience, paying attention to this, we never perform a peripheral iridectomy or peripheral iridotomy because we never had the problem of a pupillary block. So you just remember to change the vaulting to put the lens upside down or the other way, okay? So another trick in our experience, we like to hold the lens with the dominant hand. So I am a right-handed, so with my right hand, I hold the lens with the big forceps and I go inside the eye in anterior chamber then. First in anterior chamber, then I go in the posterior chamber. So I go under the iris and with my other hand, with my left hand, with the spatula, I just press both sides. So usually I go distal and I do enclavation in the distal part, and then I go proximal and I do enclavation in the proximal part, and then I go away, okay? Through paracentesis, of course. So this is our tips and tricks to get the job easy. Usually, in our experience, it's easy to do that. And also remember to avoid the cat's eye. To avoid the cat's eye, remember that when you are with the lens ready for the enclavation, so with the dominant hand, you are under the iris. And with the other hand, you have a spatula. You have to press the iris in the optics, but you have to think to press from the periphery to the center and not the contrary. You don't have to press from the center to the periphery, because if you press from the center to the periphery, you create the cat's eye, because you push the iris to the angle, and that is not good, of course. But if you press the iris from the periphery to the center, and then the other side the same, you will create a round pupil, okay? No cat's eye. Okay, this is some tricks. So results, we collected many cases, many good results. So I can say that, next slide, please, also. Okay, I can tell you briefly that we have so many big results, so many happy patients. I just can report that only in few cases, very few cases, presented with subluxation because of slippage of one of the iris claw haptic, but I think I remember 3 cases in 200 cases, so very, very few cases. And only one case presented a complete spontaneous dislocation, only one case retinal detachment, very, very few complications. 3 cases complained of blurred vision. You can go next slide, please. 3 cases complained of blurred vision when leaning forward, so not big complication. 5 cases showed severe iridodonesis, and 3 cases showed cystoid macular edema. Only 3 cases. I want to stress this because one of the typical questions or fear is that people usually ask me about cystoid macular edema postoperative, but actually it's not so common, it's rare. So if you do a good surgery, good procedure without mistakes, cystoid macular edema is not often. I can tell it. And oval pupil can see sometimes. Oval pupil means cat's eye, but I just told you how to avoid it. And some pigment dispersion can be, but very few cases. So for us, really is the gold standard in secondary IOL implantation. In my experience, and my father, Cesare Forlini, many years before me, implanted so many iris claw on the posterior surface of the iris. So I also can speak for him that really we had so many good results. And also, next slide, yes. This slide is good. Postoperative intraocular pressure is good. Only a few cases of topical anti-glaucoma drugs, but nothing more. We never had to do surgery for glaucoma. And also endothelial cell density after operation is good. We didn't find important endothelial loss. So we are very happy. So conclusion, next slide, please. I just want to close the topic of iris claw. The complications related to retropupillary iris claw IOL were minimal compared with its benefits. So we, using retropupillary implantation of the iris claw for secondary implantation, is a very valid alternative strategy to classic scleral fixed or angle support IOL implantation. For us, is the gold standard. So, Tiago, do you want me to go on with the Reper?
Yes, I would like to ask you a couple of questions. So we close the artisan aphakia subject, and we go further to any Aniridia patients and see other videos on the off-tech Reper prosthesis. You showed, or you told us that you had a big study of more than 200 patients, where you had compared also a pre-pupillar approach with a retropupillar approach. In that large study, which I think it has a follow-up, correct me if I'm wrong, is it of 5 years? What are the main differences that you see between the two? Between the two approaches, can you pick up some of the advantages or maybe disadvantages of one and the other?
Okay, well, just briefly comparison. Actually, talking about visual acuity or visual results, no differences. But in both groups, the visual acuity could be good. Astigmatism is the same because we have to open the cornea the same. So astigmatism, okay, we know there is some astigmatism post-operative, but it is the same anterior or posterior enclavation. Also, the same endothelial loss. I just said that we never found important endothelial loss after the operation, both in anterior enclavation, both in posterior enclavation. So actually, about the quality of the visual acuity, or also for about intraocular pressure, is the same. I can tell that maybe the most significant difference. I know that maybe it sounds a little bit not maybe people can say that it's not important, but actually for the patient is important. Is also the aesthetic result. Because anterior enclavation means that the lens is very visible because the lens is in front of the iris. And so, especially for young patients, because we know that many trauma cases often are young people, people for the rest of their life can see the lens, or the other people can see the lens in the eye of this patient. So,
aesthetic, maybe aesthetical could be the difference.
Yes. I mean, it's a small difference. If you do posterior enclavation, it's like a normal pseudophakia. I mean, you don't see the IOL. So that it's like maybe it's a little bit more physiological positioning of the IOL.
Thank you very much, Matteo. Maybe we can go now to our last topic, which is we're going to discuss a foldable prosthesis for aniridia patients. And Dr. Forlini has had some experiences. He's going to share with us those experiences in the form of videos as well. So I give you the floor again, Matteo, if you want to go on, please.
Okay, sure. So we are talking now about aphakia and aniridia in ocular trauma. So we know that it's a complex approach. The first question that we have to ask ourselves is there a significant iris tissue present? So if we have significant iris tissue present, we can do iridoplasty technique that I just showed you in some videos. So we can use the Sipser's technique, as I showed you, or iris cerclage technique. But if we have a very severe ocular trauma and the iris tissue is absent or almost absent, we don't have enough iris tissue to create iridoplasty. So it's impossible to do iridoplasty, so we have to choose an artificial iris prosthesis. Okay, so we know that nowadays probably the best choice that we have is the next slide, please. Okay, the best choice that we have is the artificial iris prosthesis by Reper, because this prosthesis presents many advantages. First, the cosmesis. The cosmesis is very good because Reper offers more than 300 colors options. So we really we talk with the patient. We have this a huge number of colors, and we can always find a good color for that patient. So it's like it's almost like custom made, and very good iris details. Second point, the costs. The costs is good because it's cheaper than other artificial iris prosthesis in the market. Actually, I mean, I'm talking about. in Italy, I think Europe is the same, but for Italian doctors, for Italian patients, it's like more or less 2,000 euros with IOL included, or 1,300 euros without IOL. We know that the third point, very important, is the IOL option, because Reper artificial iris has IOL included in the prosthesis. So that is very nice, because if you have aphakia and an iridia, you just can order one prosthesis for all. So when you do the order, you just specify which color and which IOL calculation. And then after a few weeks, you receive the good color with the good IOL power. So it's very, very nice and very useful for the doctors and for the patient, of course. And the last point, Tiago already said, it's foldable. So it's foldable, and that is very important, because the foldable prosthesis allows the surgeon to open the cornea not so much. Okay, you have to open the cornea a little bit. In our experience, if you have the iris, the artificial iris without IOL, so if you have only artificial iris, you can really fold the artificial iris in the cartridge, and you can implant in the anterior chamber like IOL. So you can open the cornea very, very little, like 3 millimeters. But if you have artificial iris with IOL, the whole prosthesis is a little bit stiff, a little less foldable. So usually we prefer to, you can see in the video, we use the forceps, you just bend the artificial iris prosthesis with IOL in half, and we insert in the cornea, and then it opens in the anterior chamber. And in this way, usually I open the cornea at 5.5-6 millimeters, or maybe 7, but it depends on the cases. Now I can show you two cases, so it's better to understand. So this slide is my first, this is the first case. So this was the last operation of, because this patient presented with the traumatic subluxated cataract with zonal dialysis and midriasis. So briefly, we removed the cataract, but the huge midriasis was a very fibrotic tissue. So I tried to do iridoplasty, but not possible. So the video, yes, the video, please. Okay. This operation was in the live surgery. I did that last year in December in Italy, in Rome, during live surgery, during National Congress. So you can see the iris is very rigid and not elastic. So it was not possible in this case to do iridoplasty. Usually I always try to do iridoplasty, but not possible. So the only option was artificial iris prosthesis. So I'm preparing for the implantation. So I just open the conjunctiva in 3 points, and I'm preparing 3 scleral pockets, because I'm preparing for the scleral fixation. So actually the maneuvers are very similar to a classic scleral fixation IOL. So I'm just preparing the 3 scleral pockets. The Reper artificial iris prosthesis is very nice, because already the prosthesis already has 3 small holes at 12 o'clock, at 4 o'clock, and 8 o'clock. In this way, the surgeon just has to pass the suture in the hole. So it's very, very easy, very, very, it's ready to implant. So I'm preparing the anterior chamber maintainer, because usually I always prefer to use anterior chamber maintainer, but you can always use viscoelastic material. It's up to you. In my hands, I always prefer anterior chamber maintainer, because I have a better control on the ocular pressure, and also I have a better control on the bleeding, because we know that in this kind of surgery, the bleeding can occur, and the bleeding can be very dangerous. So if I have a bleeding, I just rise up the bottle of the infusion, and it's much better for me, instead of viscoelastic. So I always use anterior chamber maintainer. Or if I am in parasplana vitrectomy, of course I have posterior infusion. But if it's anterior segment procedure, okay. And this is the artificial iris introduction. As I told you, I bended the artificial iris in two parts and then I opened it. I also prepared two of the sutures before at 4 o'clock and 8 o'clock. And so now, in this moment, the artificial iris, it's already fixed to the sclera at 4 o'clock and 8 o'clock. I am sitting at 12 o'clock, of course. And after pulling the sutures at 8 o'clock, at 4 o'clock, now I'm preparing for the last suture at 12 o'clock. You can see now. I'm using Proline 10-0, and you can see very clearly in this moment, you see the needle is entering in the small hole of the artificial iris. And now, of course, I'm passing the suture at 1.5 millimeters from the limbus, like a classic scleral fixation. So if you know how to do scleral fixation, it's the same. So you have to pay attention, of course, because you have to pull very gently the three sutures in order to obtain a very, very well centered pupil, of course. So now, after putting the last suture, I am closing the cornea, because as I said, the cornea was open at more or less 6 millimeters. So I'm closing the cornea and then I am completing the procedure. So you can see now it's well centered, the artificial iris is well centered, the pupil is well centered, and now, okay, that's it. So next slide, please. Next. Now, a little before. Okay, this is the patient in follow-up after 5 months, and you can see the result is very nice. The pupil is very well centered. The cornea is transparent. We didn't have important endothelial cell loss. So the cornea is transparent. The anterior chamber is good, is transparent, is deep. And the artificial iris is well positioned. And IOL, of course, is well centered. So the patient was very happy. And the aesthetic result also is very nice. So next slide. This is my second and last case, another severe ocular trauma. This patient presented with the corneal wound, post-traumatic aniridia and aphakia. So first time surgery, of course, corneal suture. Second time surgery was PK, so penetrating keratoplasty associated with vitrectomy. And we can see the video. So next slide, please. Okay, this is the video. So you can see that before. It's okay. So this is the PK. So I'm removing the cornea. The cornea was, you can see the corneal wound was very big. So we removed the cornea and now we are positioning the TKP, the temporary keratoprosthesis by Eckert, in order to go in the posterior chamber. So I am already positioned the three trocars. It's a 23 gauge approach. And now you can see vitreous chamber. We had the crystalline lens dropped in the vitreous chamber. So you can see the white crystalline lens luxated in vitreous chamber. So I'm performing complete vitrectomy with the peripheral shaving. And I'm always using triamcinolone to stain the vitreous. And now I'm removing the crystalline lens, you can see. It was not hard because the patient had 55 years old, so was not a big cataract. Was just a soft crystalline lens. But of course, step by step, little by little, I can remove all the crystalline lens pieces floating in the vitreous. just using the vitreous cutter. After that, I'm completing the vitreous removal up to the periphery. I'm using indentation. I'm removing vitreous from the trochars. You can see some blood clots. And then also I found retinal tear, but you know, this is the classic steps of parsplana vitrectomy. I always want to underline that in these cases, you have to perform a very, very complete vitrectomy with peripheral vitreous shaving. It's very important to remove all the vitreous to avoid postoperative complications like PVR and many, many complications. Okay, then we are still completing the vitreous removal. And now you can see the retina was still attached. And now I'm just finishing to complete the vitreous base shaving. After that, endo laser. In this ocular trauma, we always perform a 360 degrees endo laser in the peripheral. So we want to do many, many lines of endo laser. And now finished, we remove the temporal keratoprosthesis and we are completing the procedure with the final graft positioning. This is classic penetrating keratoplasty. We are positioning the final graft. You see that this is the final corner graft. And at the end, I'm just tamponade with the gas, the AR gas. So next slide, please.
Matteo, for the sake of time, we were a bit short on time. If you could try to show your conclusions.
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
This is the last video, exactly. You can run the video. This is the very last slide. Okay, and this is the same patient after three months, go back in the operating theater just to implant the artificial iris prosthesis by Reper. So again, I open the conjunctiva, I prepare the three scleral pockets, and I'm preparing for the scleral fixation of artificial iris. You can see that this is the prosthesis. Again, you can see the three small holes. So I'm preparing, again, the same concepts. I'm preparing the suture. This suture is Proline 10-0. I'm preparing the suture now at 4 o'clock and 8 o'clock. Now I am opening the cornea. In this case, this particular case, I did the corneal transplantation just 3 months before. So the corneal scar was still fresh. So I prefer to reopen the corneal wound of the previous corneal transplantation. So I just reopened the corneal wound of the corneal transplantation, and you can see I put the artificial iris inside and I put the two sutures at 4 o'clock and 8 o'clock. And at the end, I just passed the final suture at 12 o'clock. So 4 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and then 12 o'clock. Now, again, I'm just completing the sutures. Usually I use the Proline 10-0 with the, with the loop. Not double armed, single arm with loop. So in this way, I find it easier to use this kind of suture. And this is the end. I'm finding the good centration. It's very important to find the good centration of the pupil. And this is it. I close the scleral pocket. I close the conjunctiva, and this is the end of the surgery. So you can see after. Next slide, just the result. Next slide. This case after 12 months. No, the previous. After 1 year, after 12 months, you see the cornea is transparent. So the PK, I mean the corneal graft is still transparent. So I was very happy because after all the procedure, the cornea is still transparent and the pupil is very well centered and the anterior chamber is good. Everything was good. So next slide is this is kind of conclusion. And next slide again, I just want to thank you for the attention and for the kind invitation.
Thank you very much, Matteo. Very interesting surgeries. Just before we close, I have one question for you and then we will wrap it off. With your experience with the off-tech Reper lenses, did you experience any cases of glaucoma? What's your experience?
Well, yes, I found in both cases a little bit of rise of the intraocular pressure, but both patients are with topical anti-hypotonic drugs. So I'm controlling these cases with only drops. No glaucoma surgery. Okay.
And would it be maybe, I don't know if you do it, but would it be possible to make literally a little hole on the prosthesis? Would that help?
Or a little hole in the prosthesis
The aqueous circulation, or would that not
actually be? Actually, there is already aqueous circulation because the prosthesis. Okay. You see that the shape is round with three small haptics. So actually there is already a space in the periphery. So, okay, maybe a hole, it's better and better, but there is already a space. I just said that these two cases that I showed, it's with topical drugs, but I also operated other cases, and not all my cases had pressure elevated. Okay.
Right.
So it depends on the cases, but in my whole experience, I never had to do surgery for glaucoma. So
okay. Thank you very much, Matteo. I would like to thank again Dr. Apostolov for being here in Amsterdam this evening. Thank you for joining us from Italy, and thank to all of you for watching. I've noticed that we have quite a number of questions that we will not be able to answer at this moment. We will make sure to collect all of them and to talk to Dr. Apostolov and Dr. Forlini and to provide you an answer via email. So once again, thank you very much for your time, and I hope to see you on the next one.